So, just a little note before we start this video, I'm going to be shaking up the formula a little bit because my experience with this game in particular was pretty odd. I kinda got into this one in the weirdest way possible, like if you could somehow stuff a cauliflower into a blackboard, so I figured this would be the perfect time to do something I wanted to do for a while. And that was my corner-cutting review style, where it's more discussion and less analysis, mainly set over longer clips. In my head, I also wanted to pair this change with live-action bits of myself on screen, but unfortunately, I don't have the setup for that yet. Since this is going to be a new direction, feedback would be appreciated if you'd like to offer some. Anyway, let's get back to the show that you're here for. Jimmy at the right swoops out of the shadows, dropping from the night. Somewhere some villain schemes, but his number's up. 3, 2, 1. Okay, so Metal Gear Survive. This was the big chance to see if Konami could still hack it as a video game developer, and man, a lot of people would absolutely love it if that company could get back on its feet again. Back in the early days of gaming, NES, SNES, PSX era, you could not throw a dead cat around a GameStop without landing on a Konami game. They made title after title, franchises, and series, and were one of the names you used to look for when you were buying a game. But after the PT debacle, the pachinko machines, and every little newsworthy move that Konami made post-playable teaser that screamed they were done with gaming, they decided to come back to games because, love them or hate them, they make money. Especially when you slap on one of the most insulting microtransaction systems imaginable, but we'll get to that later. When I first heard about this game, I did what a ton of people were doing at the time, and I slagged it off immediately because, in all honesty, Metal Gear Survive deserved that derision. The gameplay trailer that was the first mention of this game was a colossal joke. It was pathetic, it looked slapdash, archaic, and not at all what you would expect from a company that needed to get back its good graces. The trailer made it look like just another open-world, desolate zombie game, and we have a literal metric ton of those that already exist. So getting another one was just a big ol' sigh, and what Konami was attempting to make the game unique looked so bare bones that it just made the game look that much more incompetent. Oh, we put horns on our zombies so that they could be iconic. Whoop-de-flippin', who cares? The trailer was a poo joke so bad that even Family Guy wouldn't delete its scene. So, to say the very least, I came into this game with a lot of hand-rubbing derision set to annihilate this game in terrible criticism. I was ready to hate it the moment that 2018 turned its head to look at me with its beady eyes. I knew I was buying the game just to make fun of it, but as I say in other videos, you can't truly know how good or bad something is until you play it yourself, and let's just say that the game was not making a good second impression post-trailer. The premise of the game is fan fiction grade, no joke. It was going to be a tough sell, no matter how you slice it, to have the game explained by a random wormhole opening up and taking our custom protagonist to a zombie-filled wasteland. To be absolutely fair to Yumi Tsukinuchi, or whoever Konami reanimated to take Kojima's place as the head of the Kingdom of Nonsense, you did try to make it work. The intro goes for that Kojima-style wacky seriousness of its military anime genre, but what you needed was to put some oomph and some punch behind it. Not this mediocre flipbook cutscene, where two equally boring characters at odds with each other discuss the dangers of this other dimension and how they're going to conquer it. The thing that made this work in Kojima's classics was that it was consistent through the whole game. The games kept their ridiculous political intrigues throughout the runtime of the entire title, and even though nothing was even remotely realistic or trying to be, the premise still added stakes to what was happening. The problem with Metal Gear Survive is that it's a non-Kojima Kojima game, and unfortunately that style of game is incredibly difficult to pin down because it's all in the fine details. The little things that paint the whole picture. Yeah, you can try to hit the note's broad strokes, but all you'll end up doing is making an incredibly obvious forgery. The greatest strengths of his games was that he would spin off these ludicrous circumstances involving real-world politics and covert ops into neon personality anime characters and super death weapons. And the thing that makes the style work is that even though these things are off-the-wall nuts, all the characters are still playing that it's serious and life-threatening. It takes a lot of nuance to get a Kojima game fully working, and Yumi's team simply doesn't have that charm in spite of this game being try-hard. I won't discount that there was some effort that went into this game. Even in Konami's black hole of a corporate office, deep down somewhere where the light doesn't reach, some poor employee was trying to make this game fun. This wasn't a game that was thrown together out of old shoe leather for the sake of getting a dollar as fast as possible. There's some actual effort in this game, and even in a metaphorical sense, there's a tiny bit of heart in it too. I'm surprised I can say that now after remembering the game's intro and wondering if I'd seen this game's entire landscape before. I don't blame the developers for doing this, I ultimately blame the top brass at the company for probably not even authorizing the time needed to make all the assets needed to make an entire game. But you'll find out very quickly that this game borrows a ton from Metal Gear Solid 5, to the point that I would estimate Metal Gear Survive is built out of 90% reused assets. Yep, a Konami-branded asset flip. Hell, it would be laughable to call this game a high-end ROM hack, it's so blatant with all this. Like, during the end game, it's such brazen thievery that Metal Gear Survive legitimately contains an entire level lifted straight out of Phantom Pain word for word. It's frankly hilarious to walk up to this familiar location from a totally different game and see that Konami just locked a bunch of its doors rather than bothering to redesign it to make sense for the new game that they put in it. I swear that there are whole bits of this game that were cobbled together during a Friday afternoon. And from there, everything just becomes more obvious. The user interface, the mechanics, the actual button layout from Phantom Pain, the stealth mechanics, and there's just no new work done here, and I frankly pity the people at Konami who were given all of this pre-made stuff and had to find a way to convince the players that 1970s Afghanistan looks exactly like a trans-dimensional zombie hellscape. It becomes a pretty funny joke when the game reaches Act 3 and suddenly you find yourself in a jungle that shouldn't exist. And that's all before I even reached home base, where you start this adventure and get to meet another character borrowed slash stolen from Phantom Pain. Once you and your new buddy figure a way past the zombies into a safety envelope in the red zone, you get greeted by, of all things, Mammalpod, who's managed to adopt an entirely new personality called Virgil, who explains how the game is going to work. In order to better understand Dite, this zombie dimension that the main character is in, the group that teleported in Mr. Protagonist had previously sent in an army division called the Karen Corps that went missing, and Virgil lost all his data on their mission. To start piecing together the situation, Mammalpod needs Mr. Protagonist to go into the wilderness and gather database info that the Karen Corps left behind. Now, this is where my preconceived notion from the trailer got irrevocably shattered, and I don't know why I didn't see this until Virgil's introduction. You see, the Survive subtitle of this game isn't just for show. Nope, Konami legitimately turned the Metal Gear series into an open-world zombie survival game. one of the most generic types of video games known to man. It's my fault I didn't see this coming, because from the trailer, I expected that this was going to be a basic third-person shooter with a stupid enemy in it copied 2,000 times. Nope, instead of a gun, you get a pointy stick and have to just make that work for yourself. Thankfully, I figured out my strategy for the first half of the game within the second mission. Climb on a box or a rock and just kill all of the wanderers who have no way to touch you as long as you're on a slightly high ledge. Again, this game is a comedic gold mine, considering how many times you find yourself standing over the horde of zombies, slowly taking pot shots at their heads until they all fall over and you have to slowly slit each one of their bodies to get resource points. Indeedly-do, Metal Gear Survive is one of those irritating survival games that constantly yells at you for letting your character die through really no fault of your own, because Survive is also very unforgiving. The first resource gathering in the game is done in the tutorial with a conveniently nearby dirty pond that attracted a couple pre-made animal assets from Phantom Pain that you can eat. Afterwards, Virgil tells Mr. Protagonist that the resources respawn, and they technically do, but it's so frickin' slow that you'd think that this game was Farmville. There will be points at this game if you put up with its bullshit for long enough that you'll be dying from hunger with really nothing to do about it because finding animals is so frickin' hard. They only exist in the undusted portions of the map, and there will only be two or three of them in a pack, which provides you with three meals, and even if you can grab the juiciest meat, each meal will only give you 30% of your hunger meter back. Once you figure out the boiling water recipe, you're pretty much never low on your thirst meter. Hell, you'll have so much water that you'll be using some of it to make soup. And if you need something specific like medical supplies for an upcoming challenge, then you either need to luck out hard or the game's just going to laugh at your pitiful attempts to take out five zombies with grenade launchers for arms 500 meters away from you, or you can do what the game actually wants and fork over some real-world hard code cash. Yep, Konami's good grace earning game is a microtransaction disaster to the point that it ended up ruining a lot of the game's actual features. You've heard about the game charging you for another save slot for an unbelievable $10, but honestly, if you're trying to share this game with another human being, then I think you have bigger problems than losing a little well-earned dosh. The microtransactions are cluttered in the game's defining base development mechanics to the point that I couldn't use them because they are impossible to understand. Around the halfway mark of the game, I constructed a water collector and a potato farm because those sounded like survivey type things and they'd be good to have around. The resources that they produce are so slow and nonsensical to access that I just let them rot in base camp until they ended up getting exploded by a terrible boss fight. And from there, things just get worse. The game boasts the same base development system seen in Peace Walker and Phantom Pain, but considering that there's no random soldier population to pull recruits from, and no new characters walking in to fill slots, you have no way of actually using the base development mechanics. And even then, the game demands so many microtransactions to unlock abilities of your base facilities that it turns the thing into a giant illogical sandwich no one should eat. Another terrible addition are the side quests the game has because they're so ass backwards. The way I think the game wants you to do them are to take quests for random objectives throughout the world, go and find them yourself, and then come back for a cookie if you're lucky enough to manage it. It feels like you have to go out and find the objective and then come back to base camp to complete it instead of the other way around. The rewards might have been awesome, but the implementation of them is so fucked in the head that I never bothered with it. That's the big issue with this game. There's so much stuff in it that makes no sense and doesn't even care in explaining anything. So many missed mechanics because Konami is bad at explaining everything. But I stuck with the game even though it was turning into a go to the place and pick up the memory board and come back to get the next place you need to go to and come back to the same mission over and over again with some zombie horde challenges thrown in. You know, those wave-based games that have absolutely flooded Steam and people laugh at them for being lazy shysters. That's one of Survive's biggest mechanics. The formula is simple. Set up a bunch of fences, hit the zombies with your pointy stick until they go away, and hope that there isn't too many of them to get through all of your fences. The formula doesn't change, because the game only introduces three other types of wanderers that are so rarely seen in-game that it makes you wonder why Yumi's team even bothered. There are bombers, which you already know everything you need to know by the name alone. The mortars, who are colossal dickheads who employ exploding firearms. And the, reavers? Revenants? Who are supernatural ninjas who like to skip your blockades and get straight to punching you in the head. For these situations in the late game, you get better access to firearms, which can thankfully take any wanderer form apart pretty damn quickly. It's required to have an arsenal, especially at the 15-minute defense mission, when you have to be aggressive with the zombie horde to succeed. That was fucking terrible, let me tell you, by the way. As you continue to find more memory boards and figure out what's going on, the basic gist is that the Charon Corps are all dead with no survivors after they encountered Dite, a land covered in toxic dust that kills humans. But that's not all what killed them. We don't actually learn what killed them specifically, but what we do know is that the Charon Corps were working on a method to defeat the big baddie of Dite, the Lord of Dust. A monster seeking to destroy Earth. There is a plot point at one time that says the leaders of the protagonist's company want to weaponize the Lord of Dust in classic Resident Evil fashion. Because the dissidents in the company want to destroy the beast because, well, you can't just leave the stuff around, it'll hurt someone. The Lord of Dust controls the Wanderers as well, and as it turns out, the dust that forms the hive mind of all these zombies is actually formed by advanced medical nanomachines that became sentient, so make of that what you will. The Charon Corps managed a plan to theoretically destroy the Lord of Dust, and that was to weaponize Salanthropus, which is in Dite for some unexplained reason, but to be frank, since every character in the game seems to have no reason for coming to Dite, I suppose that Dite just randomly sucks stuff in from other dimensions just like in the Dark Tower books. There's a shout out for all my Stephen King fans. At this point, it's getting pretty late in the game. We have cool weapons, we have a bunch of resources, and we're getting pretty confident, and after that terrible 15-minute defense to gather Solanthropus, things are going pretty smoothly. The stealth in this game is absolute bullshit. There's no point to even using it since the only benefit you get is the ability to stealth kill zombies, which is difficult in of itself since the zombie will probably detect you're behind it before you can backstab it, even if you're right behind it. And there's no consequence for fucking up the stealth since you can outrun the zombies with a walking pace. And even if everything else fucks up and you have to fight the zombies, just get on a rock and you'll cheese the entire conflict with no hits being taken. Which is good because the combat can also suck a pile of farts. Metal Gear Survive is one of those games where the game's animations lock the player into the actions, so if you see a zombie about to attack you, you are going to be taking that hit no question, because there's little you can do to stagger them. Pro tip, never, ever, ever use a melee weapon in this game. Never, ever, ever. They are totally useless. Since the game tends to focus on hordes of multiple enemies and the stark lack of being able to stun anybody, if you run into a group of enemies and start throwing around your machete, you'll most likely be eating a zombie fist to the skull, and because of how the game's combos and stuns work, if you get hit by a zombie who only use combo attacks, never single punches, you'll be getting hit by the punch after that, and another one for good measure, which has a 70% chance of giving you a status ailment along with taking away 40% of your health bar. It's such a stupidly high punishing combat engine that it almost gives sticker stars a run for its money. This stupidity sandwich gets all the more spicy in the 15-minute defense, which is just wave after wave after motherfucking wave of zombies that'll eat through all of your resources and laugh at you when you realize you can't go back to home base to get any more of them just for this one mission. Yeah. Fuck you too, Konami. At least we get Solanthropus out of that deal. Well, half of the robot, which is still good! Not complaining there. With the iconic beastie now in our possession, we are ready to start taking on the Lord of Dust. And if there's one credit that modern Konami can have for Metal Gear Survive, it's this. The Lord of Dust, which isn't a pre-built asset, is a damn cool looking monster. It is a 30-foot tall tube sock with 14 legs covered in slate boulders. It's a mysterious, powerful, and inspired monster design, and it's the best thing that this game can offer, mostly because you'll actually find the Lord of Dust before you can see it in-game, most likely, because just like Deathwing from World of Warcraft, damn, how old is that reference? The Lord of Dust will just be wandering around the overworld, and you'll find it by its telltale earthquake footsteps, and it's such a good staple of this game because it happens so infrequently, and in the background, that it adds some much-needed nuance to the game's survival missions, wondering how in the ever-loving hell are you gonna be killing that monster? Well, I'll tell you how. In Survive's final mission, you'll be defeating the Lord of Dust by doing another round of wave-based zombie murder. Yep, final bit of the game is some rehashed zombie waves and a couple QTEs. Remembering that the Lord of Dust set piece was using Solanthropus is the ultimate letdown because this could have easily been the Ray vs. Rex boss fight all over again if Konami would have put in the effort to make it happen. But no, it's just firing a gun twice at the thing until it falls over because nothing about Survive could have gone right. Metal Gear Survive is essentially what would happen if you let a 12-year-old try to make cookies. They'll try. They'll really, really try, read the recipe over and over again, ask tons of questions, yet they still can't escape their ludicrous incompetence, and whatever they make will be bland at best and burnt at worst. Once I finished it, all I could say about Metal Gear Survive was that it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. Which isn't saying much. The difference between a 2 and a 4 out of 10 game isn't miles long, but considering the complete shamelessness of Konami trying to milk more money out of its players, to the point that it's willing to cut off half the features of the damn game and drown the other half in unexplainable jargon, you really should stay 500 meters away from this game at all times. I'm surprised that it didn't spontaneously combust once I touched the disc. But even with the attempts to break up the usual survival game formula, the game doesn't do enough right to get away from it feeling like a desperate cash-in just going through the typical Steam game motions with go to the place and get the thing gameplay. The game never changes throughout its runtime, it's always the same zombies, the same fences, the same hordes, and the same stick jabbing to get through all of it. And one casualty of this problem was the eventual twist in the plot, where it's revealed that Dite isn't actually another dimension, but it's actually Earth, set a couple centuries in the future, where the Lord of Dust traveled back in time and ravaged the planet, leaving this desolate zombie wasteland. And then we learn that the whack job who sent us the Dite under false pretenses at the start of the game turns out to be one of our support characters who was sent back in time to figure out a way to get everybody else back home, which they never do, because how will they continue making micropayments if the story ends, guys? Metal Gear Survive was Konami's big chance to show the world that it was still committed to the gaming market and earn the huge bucks of it with some quality product. But instead, shat the bed so hard that you can't even see the sheets anymore. What Konami needed to do was pull out all the stops and bring together some big ideas to create something remarkable to get its name back in the ring. But what it instead did was pick the most overused bargain basement video game idea and then cobble the entire thing out of assets that it shamelessly stole from their last successful title and called it a day. The game is pathetic, a shell of an experience that can't even be filled in with insulting DLC. It's a desperate cash-in, a middle finger to the legacy of the franchise it's using for attention. Seriously, if this game was named anything else, I doubt Konami would have been able to build hype for it at all. But instead, it smeared liquid poo over the Metal Gear IP and showed that you should expect less than nothing from this uncaring, idiotic developer who couldn't give give a crap about anything, even if its ass was on fire. So with that being said, let's go to the scoreboard and show off what this zombie-filled wasteland was really worth. Oh, and I can't forget to send you guys off with a victory for gamers. I hope you enjoyed this new type of video, and if you did, I would love to see a comment. I'll see you guys next time for a less cynical product showcase.